Half a day, students. My name is Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. As we battle this COVID-19 outbreak, I want you to know that together, Governor Liu and I are working very hard to do everything within our power to keep our island safe from COVID-19. In addition, we have been working closely with the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam to bring you continuous educational curriculum while you stay home during this time. With that said, Governor Liang Guerrero and I want you to remember to stay safe. This means listening to your parents. Wash your hands for at least 20 seconds and wash your hands frequently. Together, we will get through this. To our parents, the governor and I know how important it is that we stay diligent in our efforts to keep our students of Guam healthy and safe. Thank you for stepping in with your child's education during this time. I would also like to thank each and every member of the Guam DOE team, teachers and support staff, for their hard work, boundless energy, and for their commitment to our students of Guam. To our students, we hope that you enjoy PBS University while at home. Have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by the Guam Department of Education, PBS Guam, and in conjunction with public school teachers to create lessons that students will be able to easily follow. With the aim of helping students continue their learning at home, providing both parents and students with a unique educational experience. PBS University on PBS Guam.
Half a day, my name is John Fernandez, Superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. I want to begin by thanking you all for staying home and staying safe during the current COVID-19 pandemic. Let's continue to do our part by practicing good hygiene, social distancing, and staying home. I know it's not easy, but we can do this. Remember, we are all in this together. I know you understand why we had to close schools down for the rest of the school year, and I want you to know that your safety, the safety of your families, and the safety of employees come first. But let's not give up on teaching and learning. As you know, we have already provided a set of distance learning resources that are now on our website at www.gdoe.net. Now we're taking it to the next level with the help of Guam Public Broadcasting Service, better known as PBS, which will contain televised weekly lessons developed by our teachers and staff for students from K-12. These will be simple but effective lessons for students to work on at home, and they will include lessons in reading, math, and character development. These lessons will be updated weekly for the remainder of the school year and into the summer. Students, here's your opportunity to keep your mind sharp while you're stuck at home over the next few weeks. And parents, I hope that this will assist you in providing your children with dedicated instructional time and support. I want to close by just thanking those people on the front lines of the COVID-19 fight, our healthcare professionals, including our very own DOE school nurses and social workers, our law enforcement professionals, including our very own DOE student attendance officers and school resource officers, our principals and school staff, who along with Sodexo employees serve 24,000 school meals to feed our island's children, our food and nutrition employees, who are delivering food supplies to our nonprofit and government partners to assist needy families, and our teachers and staff who have worked hard to make distance learning a reality. Finally, a message to students. Keep a positive attitude. Keep learning. We miss you, and we'll see you soon in the new school year. Siduos maasi, and stay safe.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to PBS University. I'm Mrs. Flores, and in today's video, we're going to be talking about science. Science is the study of the world all around us. Scientists, the people who study science, learn from subjects, or the thing that they're studying. Scientists learn about their subjects by observing, describing what they see in their observations, and experimenting. Most scientists study particular things. For example, a scientist who studies fossils of dinosaurs is called a paleontologist. A scientist who studies the stars and space is called an astronomist. And a scientist who studies about the land is called a geologist. In this video, I'm going to be a biologist, or a scientist who studies living things. And the subject that I chose to study is bacteria. Bacteria are tiny living creatures that are everywhere in the world. Some bacteria is helpful for us, and some bacteria is harmful for us. And if we get that harmful bacteria inside our bodies where it doesn't belong, it could make us really sick. Over the last few months, we've been hearing about ways to keep ourselves healthy. Simple things that we can do to keep ourselves from picking up harmful viruses or bacteria that are all around us. Things like wear a mask, practice physical distancing by staying 6 feet away from other people. If you're feeling sick, stay home and wash your hands. After hearing about hand washing for so long, I got curious. I had some questions that I wanted to answer. And so I decided that I would follow the 6 steps of thinking like a scientist. The first step in thinking like a scientist is to identify a problem or a question that you want answered. After hearing about all these ways to keep ourselves healthy for the last few months, I had 2 questions that I wanted to answer. The first question is, are hand sanitizers and hand washing really that important? And which surface in my house is the dirtiest? The second step of thinking like a scientist is to create a hypothesis. A hypothesis is when you take all the information that you already know and make a prediction about what you think is going to happen when you conduct your experiment. For my first experiment, I want to know if hand sanitizers work as well as hand soap, or if washing your hands with soap is better than using a hand sanitizer. I know what I predicted. I know my hypothesis, but I'm not going to share it yet because later in the video, I'm going to send you guys an email and I want you to tell me what you think is going to happen in the experiment. For my second experiment, I wanted to find out which surface in my house is the dirtiest, which surface has the most bacteria. So I chose 5 high-touch areas in my home. High-touch areas are places that have lots of hands that touch them all throughout the day, because the more times an object is touched, the more chances you have of leaving bacteria on it. For my experiment, I chose the doorknob for the front door of the house, the light switch for the kitchen, the refrigerator handle, the handles on the bathroom sink, and the remote control. I know which surface I think is the dirtiest, and I've made my hypothesis. But again, I'm not gonna share it yet because I wanna hear from you. Which surface do you think is the dirtiest? The third step of thinking like a scientist is to gather your materials. For these science experiments, I didn't have any fancy scientific tools like microscopes, but I did have some pretty common objects that most people have in their homes or are easy to find at the store. For my first experiment, I want to see which is more effective, hand sanitizer or hand soap. So for this experiment, I needed a couple slices of bread, and I chose bread that was baked at a local bakery, a marker, a zip top bag. Now, I like zip top bags because you can seal it shut and you can be sure that nothing else is touching your bread while you're making your observations. But you don't need to use a zip top bag. If you can use a regular sandwich bag or other kind of plastic bags, you just need to be sure that nothing else is touching your bread while you make observations. I also needed 1 pair of latex gloves, some hand sanitizer, some hand soap, and a timer. And for this experiment, I used the timer on my cell phone. For my second experiment, finding out which surface in my home is the dirtiest, I needed more slices of bread. I used the same loaf as I did for experiment 1, so this bread was baked at the same local bakery. a marker. Zip top bags, sandwich bags, or any other container that can prevent anything from coming in contact with the bread you're observing. And gloves. For this experiment though, I needed 6 pairs of gloves. The fourth step of thinking like a scientist is to conduct the experiment. Conducting an experiment is a very critical part of thinking like a scientist. While you're conducting the experiment and making all your observations, it is very important that you document everything you're doing very clearly. Scientists sometimes will repeat the same experiment over and over again to make sure that the results that they're going to share are accurate. If I complete the same experiment 3 times and I get the exact same result all 3 times, then I know that those results are valid. If I conduct an experiment 3 times and I get 3 different results, then that experiment might not be so valid, and I need to go back and be sure that I'm following the exact same procedures every time I complete that experiment. Another thing that scientists do is they'll let other scientists try to repeat their experiment to see if the results are the same. So as you're writing down your procedures and the things you observe, it's important for you to be clear enough that someone who didn't do the experiment with you will be able to repeat that experiment in a different environment. Thinking like a scientist takes time. And I didn't have enough time in this video to go through all the steps of thinking like a scientist. So you'll have to tune in next week to see the results of this experiment. But I would love to hear what your hypothesis is for each of my experiments. You can send me an email with your ideas at ss-pbs-help@gdoe.net. I hope to hear from you before next week, so that we can have lots of hypotheses to compare the results to. I'm really excited to share the results of my experiment with you, so I hope to see you next week. Until then, bye!
Hi, this is Ms. Powers. I'll be your 3rd through 5th grade teacher for character education this week. And we'll be talking about healthy decision making. So, I was at the store the other day and I bought these new glasses. The sales lady told me they look great on me. You want to see? What do you think? Right? Awesome, huh? No? They don't look good? What do you mean? Could the sales lady be lying to me? Oh, well, maybe I should have trusted my own instincts, because I kind of thought they looked silly too, but I don't know. She told me they looked so good, so I went ahead and bought them. Do you ever make decisions like that, where someone tells you something looks good or is good, and so you try it? Like, last night, somebody told me bitter melon was good, so I tried it in my dinner, and it was horrible. I tried it on somebody else's advice, but yeah, something I would not do again. So when you make decisions and they're not good ones, you need to stop and think about them and evaluate whether why you made that decision and how to avoid that decision in the future. So next time I won't listen to the store clerk. And now I know I don't want to eat bitter melon. But there are other choices in life that you make on a day-to-day basis. And all your choices have consequences. They could be good or bad consequences, but they affect you and the world around you. Say, for example, I had a choice of fruits. Maybe I had an orange from the store that came from the US, or a mango that I picked out in my yard. I'd have to choose which one to eat. Well, they're both tasty and they're both nutritious. But if I choose the orange, I've chosen a fruit that had to be grown and shipped all the way across the world to get to me. And that means that a lot of fossil fuels went into getting this little orange here to Guam for me to consume. If I choose the mango, I went outside and it was free and there were no fossil fuels burned in making it. So I'm helping to prevent global warming, which is part of a goal of mine, a personal goal. Do you have any goals? Like maybe you want to join the soccer team this year? Okay, so there would be lots of little decisions that get you to the point where you could be a good soccer player. For example, if you got up every day and exercised, and if you went for runs every time you had a chance, and if you ate healthy most of the time, and you showed up for practices regularly and listened to your coach, and you researched ways to be a better soccer player online. Those are all small decisions, but when you do them multiple times, they add up to really help you get towards your goals. So now, what if you made a bunch of other small decisions and you were trying to get on the soccer team? For example, what if you slept in late and didn't go for runs ever? You skipped a lot of workouts. You missed quite a few practices. You didn't take your coach seriously. Do you think that that's a good way to get on the soccer team? No, that won't improve your physical ability to play as a good teammate. That will have negative consequences. Let's talk about other kinds of decisions you have to make. You have to make decisions about what you put in your body. So for example, if you go to the doctor's office because you're sick and the doctor prescribes you some medicine, that's called prescription medicine and it will have directions on there. And it's okay to take that if your parents give it to you because they want you to take it because to get better. Another kind of medicine that the doctor may or may not tell you to take are over-the-counter medicines. And they could be anything from like gummy vitamins to vitamin C to like a pain reliever like Tylenol or Advil. And that's okay to take as well as long as your parents give it to you and follow the directions on the label. There's another kind of drug, and those are illegal drugs. And those are things like crystal meth and cocaine and pills that weren't prescribed to you. And those are illegal because they are not good for your health and they can cause long-term and short-term negative consequences. And so please stay away from those because they will not help you reach your goals. And there's another kind of drugs that are illegal if you're under 21. And that's things like cigarettes, vape, alcohol. And those are drugs that are legal, but may harm developing bodies and brains. And they aren't good for your health. And so you may not take those unless you're an adult. And then you can decide whether that's a good thing for you or not. Another time you get to make decisions is when you do outdoor activities. It's like, say for example, you go for a hike. Do you like to hike? I do. Yeah. Do you ever go alone? No, that's dangerous. You need to go with a buddy and let another person or a group of people know where you're headed to. Another decision you have to make when you go hiking is you need to check the weather and see if there's supposed to be any thunderstorms or flash floods. Because if there could be flash flooding, which is prone at this time of year, then It could make the rivers swell very quickly, and you may not be able to cross out of the trail the same way you came in, and it may become very dangerous. So those are decisions you have to make, is to keep yourself safe. Look ahead. If you're going to be out in nature, you need to find out about the weather. For example, if you're going to go swimming, you might need to know if the waves are going to be big in the area you're going to. And also, when you go swimming, you need to take what with you? A buddy. That's right. And you should always ask permission from an adult or have an adult come and supervise you when you go swimming. You should evaluate your choices before you make a decision. You need to look at the choices and decide if that choice you're looking at making will support your goals or your values as a person. And if they don't, then you need to find a different choice or goal. And then after you make your decision and carry it out, then go back and reflect on it. Look back and see what happened. Did you get the consequences you wanted? If you did, then celebrate. If you didn't, then you need to look at other options and how you could align a choice that's better aligned with your values or goals, so that next time you can make a better decision. So, I gave you several examples of healthy decisions that help you support your goals in life and unhealthy decisions that do not support your goals. And we make both of those in our life. It happens. And we make choices every day. So what I want you to do is think about a choice that you made today or over the last week. I want you to write about it. Tell me exactly what the choice was that you did and how it affected your goals. Now, if it negatively affected your goals, I want you to think about it and list out a different decision you could make in the future that will help you support your goals. Because we reach our goals and get to where we want to be in life, whether it's in the dream house or the job we want or being able to support our family, by making little steps in the right direction. So every little step you make does affect you in some small way. And making a bunch of small, good decisions that support your goals will really add up. All right, until next week, happy reflecting.
Do you know how to find the perimeter and the area of shapes? Hey guys, Ms. Torres here with PBS University. That's right, today we're going to talk about perimeter and area. Go grab some paper and a pencil, because we're going to solve some problems together and you're going to do some on your own. The perimeter is the distance around the outside of a shape. How do we find the perimeter? It's the sum of all the sides. Let's try a couple problems together. Here's the first one. 16 units by 7 units. This is what it looks like. Perimeter equals side plus side plus side plus side. How would it look for this problem? Just like this. You got it? Pretty easy. All right, solve for the perimeter. Hope you got what I got. 46 units. Good job. Here's our next example. Don't worry, same process. Just a few more sides. Let's plug them in. Looks like this. Add them all up. Did you get 42 units? You're on the right track. Good job, because we're going to practice. Well, I meant you're actually going to practice. Here's the first one. Don't forget, sum of all sides. Did you get it? 24 meters. Good job. Here's your next one. Did you get 20 centimeters? You got it. Great. Don't worry. Remember, sum of all sides. Did you get it? 32 centimeters? Awesome. And your last one. Don't worry. Remember, opposite sides are the same length. 9 centimeters is 9 centimeters. 4 centimeters across is also 4 centimeters. Now solve for your perimeter. Did you get 26 centimeters? You guys are rock stars. Now, let's move on to area. Area is the measure of the space inside the shape. Now, it's a little bit different. Look at how we write it. Area equals length times the width. But because we're multiplying, you've got to remember this. This is what it looks like. Length times width, units squared. There are two lengths and there are two widths. This is why you got to square it, like double it. Here's our first example. So remember, area equals length times width. So if we replace the length and the width, this is what this problem should look like. That's right, 10 times 6. I think I know. Yes, I know. I meant to say, I think you know your multiplication facts. So this area is 60 units squared. Don't forget the units squared. Here's our next example. And again, area equals length times width. So if we substitute the length and the width, this is what we get. That's right, 8 times 5. And I know you know 8 times 5. That's right, 40 units squared. You got this, no problem. Now it's time to practice. Don't forget, area is length times width. Here's your first problem. Did you get it? 32 meters squared? Yeah, it's not too hard. Good job. Here's the next one. I got 24 centimeters squared. How about you? You got it. Great. Here's the next one. 6 centimeters by 7 centimeters. What do you get? That's right. 42 centimeters squared. Awesome. Here's the last one. Don't worry. Each square represents 1 square centimeter. So count how many squares along the first row. That's right, 4 centimeters. How about going down the side? Another 4 centimeters. You got it. Now, solve for area. Pretty easy. Did you get 16 centimeters squared? You guys are rock stars. There's Miss Selena. We're going to measure the length and the width of my yard. We're starting with the length, number 1. We've moved to the 10. There's 20 square feet. We're at 30, or past 30. Now 40. Oh, my yard's pretty long. Oh, 50. Oh, we're getting close. Can you take a guess? 60. Are we going to make it? 69 plus 2, 71. Now we're working on the width. Miss Selena's doing a great job. Okay, we're at 10. Papers are still flying. It was a windy day when we did this. Oh, we're at 20. Oh, almost there. She's got to go around the bush. And we get to 37. Here's an aerial view of my yard. After Miss Selena measured it, this is what it looks like on paper. 71 feet by 37 feet. Now I wonder how much fencing I need to buy if I've got to replace it. Do you know something that might help me? Perimeter, you're right. We know the perimeter is the sum of all the sides. So I'll plug in my sides, and this is what it looks like. And I use my calculator just to be sure. I would need to buy 216 feet of fencing just to replace mine. That's a lot. How about if I needed to grow some more grass? How much sod would I need to buy to grow grass? How can I figure that out? You're right. I need to use area. We know area is length times width. So again, I'll substitute my length and width in. 71 times 37. And you bet I use my calculator because I have to buy a lot of sod. 2,627 square feet of it. That's a lot of sod. So you can see how I use perimeter and area to find out how much fencing I might need to buy or how much sod I might need to buy. I wonder how you could use perimeter and area at your house to help you solve some problems. Or maybe later on, when we get back to school, how about you send me some of your ideas to pbs-ss-help@gdue.net. Hey guys, it is game time and we have Miss Selena.
Hi.
So, first things first, deck of cards. I'll explain the spinner in just a minute, but each player has to pick two cards, so I'll pick my first card. I got a one.
I have an eight.
And my second card is a three.
And I have a four.
So this is where the spinner comes in. And you'll notice on the screen, the spinner, largest area, largest perimeter, smallest area. So I'm gonna use my pencil and the paper clip to spin. And the winner for this round is the one who has the largest area. And I can tell you right away that I lost because length of three times width of one, you know what it means. Three times one is only three. Ms. Selena, what did you get?
Eight times four is 24.
Eight times four is 32.
32, sorry.
So that's okay. I practiced, but she still wins. Let's try one more. Okay, Ms. Selena, you pull the first card.
I have a five.
Okay, my first card is a two.
And I have a three.
And I have a seven. Okay, so Ms. Selena, you spin now.
Smallest perimeter.
Okay, smallest perimeter. So remember, we need to double and then double and add. Okay? Okay, so I've got mine. Double your five. What is that?
That's 10.
Double your three?
Six.
What is 10 plus six?
16.
16. So Ms. Selena is 16. My double is seven, and seven is... 14, that's right. 2 and 2 is 4, so 14 and 4 is 18. Woo, woo, woo! 14 beats bad. Okay, so very easy way to practice using a deck of cards, which most of us have, and just some objects around the house to create a spinner. Okay, go and have some fun.
Bye.
We've now come to the end of our lesson for perimeter and area. Try out these problems and send your answers to me at pbs-ss-help@gdoe.net. You can use this link to get this assessment and even more worksheets, some challenges, and even a game. So until our next adventure, bye!
Citizen science is a pretty broad term. What it means for me is all of us being aware of what's happening around us. And to me, science means creating a solution to this.
And by this, Mike Ottman, the chair of the Maui Surfrider chapter, means plastic. And Jenny Roberts from the Pacific Whale Foundation explains just how dangerous plastic is to our environment.
So actually we are finding that the microplastics or the small piece of plastics are actually the bigger problem. So plastic never truly biodegrades. The first piece of plastic ever created still exists today. And all it does is it photodegrades, which means it breaks down into smaller and smaller pieces. And those smaller pieces are what we call microplastics. And those can be even more dangerous than the big ones because those microplastics are what the microorganisms are eating. And then the bigger fish that eats those microorganisms, then they're ingesting plastic. And then up the food chain it goes to the fish you eat on your dinner plate.
and one of the best places to collect data on this plastic problem is the northwest coast of Maui. Here, Cheryl King, a marine biologist on Maui, collects data on the many plastics she finds.
Everything you could possibly imagine washes ashore here, and we record all that, and then at the end of the day, we have all that information to show that, okay, we have a serious problem for these items.
Yeah, that's a good thing. Then we've got to look at
the Pacific, the Atlantic, the Indian Ocean, they all have these concentration points of debris because of the way the currents and the winds move. It's not like a floating island that you can go out and just pick it up really easily. It's more of a plastic soup that's not just floating, but it's also down, all the way down the sea floor.
Not very exact, is it?
You know, we're trying, like endeavors that we can do on a local basis and a global basis, it's changing. It's definitely getting out there as far as the message.
And it's not enough to know what the problem is, but how to take action.
I think beach cleanups are the first step. For me, it created awareness that, oh my gosh, actually when you look down, you see it all, the little bits of trash on our favorite beaches. The turtles, the fish, the wildlife eating it. So to me, the beach cleanup is creating that awareness that will move towards making steps towards change.
And these steps are creating a path that many around the world are following, including Amy the Fumboy, a volunteer on one of the many beach cleanups on Maui.
Anywhere I go, I always try and get involved in the community and get to know people and their perspective on the local aspect, because I think that's really important, especially with tourism nowadays. It's become so massive, like such a large aspect of everyone's really routine or lifestyle, that when you do travel, I think it's important to give back to the communities that you're traveling to. In the long run, if everyone really takes those little steps, it would really become a massive movement. And I think our society is really coming a long way with that.
And Claire agrees.
All kids should clean up the mess.
This is Caitlin Amuro reporting for Student Reporting Labs.
Hafide, everyone. Welcome to PBS University. I'm Mr. Borja. This week for social studies, we're working on our map skills. So, what comes to mind when you think of maps? Most kids I've asked, they say they think of treasure maps. But have you ever seen other kinds of maps, or maybe even made your own map before? If you haven't, then don't worry. You'll know everything you need to know in a few minutes, and you'll be an expert cartographer in no time. A cartographer is a person that makes maps. What are maps and why are they so useful? A simple way to think of it is a map is a picture of a place. And we use a map to show where certain things are, like hidden treasure. And maps, they can also show us what direction to go if we want to get from one place to another. And they help us figure out how far things and places are from each other. But before you start making maps or trying to read maps, you should know the parts of a map. Most maps have four important parts. The first is a map title, and I think this is a really important part. I mean, come on. You don't want to be using a map of Spain when you're trying to find some place in Guam. So yeah, the map has to have a title. The next part is a compass rose. The compass rose shows directions, north, south, east, and west. These are the cardinal directions, and this is important so we know which way to go. The third part of a map is the distance scale. A distance scale shows that a certain length on the map equals a certain length in a real place. And most distance scales show distance in miles and kilometers. And the last part is the map key, or legend. See, maps often use symbols or colors to represent things, and the map key explains what they mean. So let's look at some maps and see if we can find the different parts. So what is this a map of? Did you say it's a map of Guam? And How do you know that? Okay, yeah. I know some of you are saying, I know what Guam looks like. But if you didn't, then you would look right here and see that it says Guam. Nice job. You found the map title. Okay, look at this map of the United States. Where is the compass rose on this map? Right on. You found it. Okay, how about a distance scale? Look at this one and tell me, up to what distance does the scale go to in miles? Yes, 5 miles is correct. All right, now let's look at a completely different type of map. Here's a map of the Micronesia Mall, and this map has an excellent example of a map key. I mean, just look at all the symbols for places in the mall. For example, they use a capital letter P in a box to show where all the parking areas are. Okay, you ready to try one? According to this map, how many restrooms are there? Did you say 3? That's right. The symbol for restroom is a picture of a man and a woman standing next to each other. And on this map, there are 3 of those symbols. Good job. Okay, cool. So there it is. A nice introduction to maps. You're all set to read maps, and more importantly, you're ready to make those awesome treasure maps. So, we know the parts of a map, but what if you wanted to describe a specific location on a map? How would you do that? Let's watch this video and see.
I hate to say this, but I think we're lost.
A plan. We need a plan. I've got it! I'll copy Motherboard's map onto my squad pad and send it to both of yours. Map coming through. Now what?
Look for a landmark.
That must be Haystack Mountain. We know where we are again. See? That mountain matches the shape and position of the Haystack Mountain icon.
Excellent.
Meet you at the hill with the flat top. You see it?
You mean the hill past Haystack? Or the one next to the geyser?
We'll never match up the landmarks this way.
Wait a minute. Inez, do you see the grid on your map?
Do you mean these lines that sort of look like graph paper?
Right. What if we mark the vertical lines with letters from left to right?
You mean like A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H?
Yes. Now, mark the horizontal lines with numbers from bottom to top.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
I get it. Each landmark is on the grid somewhere. If we're at Haystack Mountain here on the island, then we're at G4 on the map. Cool.
And if we're at the waterfall, we're at E3.
Okay, there's a bridge on the way at D6. Let's meet there.
Excellent. Let's keep in touch. See you at D6.
Bridge at D6. We made it!
Inez!
Yes! I owe you one, Matt.
We're here!
So what did the Cyber Squad do to make finding each other easier? Right. They used a coordinate grid. An example of a coordinate grid you might be familiar with is the lines of latitude and longitude on a globe. Each place on the globe has a specific coordinate that you can use to locate that place. The coordinate grid makes it possible to describe a location on the map more clearly. And what's super cool is that you can use a coordinate grid on just about any map. Look at this map of the Borja house that my son drew. We can take a coordinate grid and lay it right over the drawing. Then, just like the Cyber Squad, we can label the horizontal and vertical lines of the grid. Okay, so in this example, what is located in D1? Yep, that's the kid zone. And where would you find the living room? Good job, the living room is in B1 and B2. Okay, let's try another picture. Here's a map of Sugarland. Do you see all the parts of the map? Nice. Now, let's put that coordinate grid over the top and do some practice. Where would you be if you were in C5? Did you say you'd be showering in the chocolate falls? Oh yeah, that sounds sweet. All right, we've got time for one more. If you visited the gingerbread village, what coordinate would you go to? D4 is where you should go. Hey, that's going to be it for today. Great job, as always. Keep up the good work and keep practicing those map skills. I mean, there are so many other types of maps out there, but now you've got what it takes to read them. And of course, try making your own maps. Give them to a friend or family member and see if they can find their way using your map. Till next time, take care.
Hafiday Guam, welcome to PBS University. I'm Mrs. Ryan Pegrito, your third, fourth, and fifth grade literacy teacher. I have a special story for you today, but first, let's read our objectives. Read it with me. I can read a story and identify descriptive words and phrases. I can use descriptive language to express my ideas about a topic. In today's story, the author uses descriptive writing. Learning about descriptive writing helps us to improve our writing by making it more interesting and engaging to read. Good descriptive writing appeals to our senses. Do you remember what our five senses are? Sight, hearing, smell, taste, and touch. Awesome! The story we will read today is called Fry Bread, a Native American family story. The author uses descriptive writing to share about a traditional Native American food, fry bread. But the story is a lot more than just bread. The author also uses descriptive writing to share about Native American survival, culture, and heritage. Let's read and find out more. As we read the story, pay careful attention to descriptive writing. Remember, descriptive writing appeals to our five senses: sight, hearing, touch, smell, and taste.
Fry Bread, a Native American family story, written by Kevin Noble Maylard, illustrated by Juana Martinez Neal. Fry bread is food: flour, salt, water, cornmeal, baking powder, perhaps milk, maybe sugar, all mixed together in a big bowl. Fry bread is shape. Hands mold the dough, flat like a pancake, round like a ball, or puffy like Nana's softest pillow. Fry bread is sound. The skillet clangs on the stove. The fire blazes from below. Drop the dough in the skillet. The bubbles sizzle and pop. Fry bread is color. Golden brown, tan, or yellow. Deep like coffee, sienna, or earth. light like snow and cream, warm like rays of sun. Fry bread is flavor. See beans or soup, smell tacos, cheese, and vegetables. Delight in honey and jam. Rise to discover what brings us together. Fry bread is time. On weekends and holidays, supper or dinner, powwows and festivals, moments together with family and friends. Fry bread is art, sculpture, landscape, portrait, our daily craft, shared from teacher to student, a cycle of heritage and fortune. Fry bread is history, the long walk, the stolen land, strangers in our own world. With unknown food, we made new recipes from what we had. Fry bread is place. Alaska, Kansas, all the way to Maine, down to Delaware, on to Georgia, over to Oklahoma, Colorado, and California. Cities and lands we all call home. Fry bread is nation. Abenaki, Apache, Arapaho, Ojibwe, Onondaga, Oglalasu, Narragansett, Navajo, Nipmuc, Seminole, Shoshone, Sac and Fox. Hundreds and hundreds of tribes. Fry bread is everything. Round, flat, large, small, north, south, east, west, brown, yellow, black, white, familiar and foreign, old and new, we come together. Fry bread is us. We are still here, elder and young, friend and neighbor. We strengthen each other to learn, change, and survive. Fry bread is you.
Wow, what an amazing story. There are so many descriptive words and phrases. It felt like I was in the story. The author uses fry bread to discuss the importance of recognizing the Native American people. Bread has always been an important part of life. In many cultures, it was a staple food for survival because of its nutritional value. On our island of Guam, Chamorros make flatbread. Do you know what this is called in the Chamorro language? You see it on fiesta tables. It's flat. It's round, sometimes cut into triangles, and it tastes really good with kalaguin. Right, Tutitas. According to Guampedia, Tutitas was introduced in the Spanish era of the 17th century. It was an important food, especially during times of famine or food shortages. I would very much like to share my Tutitas recipe with you today. Let's head to the kitchen.
Welcome to Cooking Tutitas with Mrs. Pegorito. These are the items that you will need. First, you will need a mixing bowl. Combine flour, baking powder, and sugar. Mix the ingredients together. What does it look like? White, dry, powdery. Next, add shortening. Now what does it look like? Sticky? Crumbly. Mix it all together. You can use an electric mixer for faster results. Listen, what do you hear? Grinding, blending. Now we add coconut milk. Ooh, what does coconut milk taste like? Sweet, creamy. Let's keep mixing until we have just the right consistency to create dough. Looks great. Time to knead. What do you think this feels like? Soft, sticky, puffy, stretchable. Now we roll the dough, first by shaping them into small balls. It feels like light and airy little spheres. Now we take two parchment papers and place the dough between them. With the rolling pin, flatten the dough. Now how would you describe what you see? It looks smooth, round, flat like a pancake. Heat a skillet and place the dough on it. Once you see it rise and brown on the edges, it's time to flip. Mmm, it smells delicious. It kind of smells like a bakery in here. Once done, cut the tzatzitas into smaller pieces. The holiday spirit is all about sharing. Wow, it's so warm and toasty. And here you have it, boys and girls. Mrs. Pegarito's special sweet flour tzatzitas. Yay!
Wow, that was so much fun. And those were great words you used to describe tzatzitas and how to make it. Remember, if you're going to try this at home, make sure you're with a responsible adult, especially if you're working the stove. You know, my aunt was the one who taught me how to make tzatzitas. And now, I can pass that recipe on to you. Don't we have a very special and unique culture? More descriptive words. Special, unique, just like you. I had so much fun with you guys today. I'll see you next time. Bye.